Okay, so thank you very much for your invitation to speak about chemical ecology and pheromone on the honeybees. It's a fascinating topic, and many of us have already opened a colony. And when we see hundreds and thousands of bees working together, it's always fascinating, and the big question is how can they do that to develop the colony and to swarm and to be able to develop their colony harmoniously. So there is some keys to understand this question. It's communication, a very important aspect to communicate. Division of labor and plasticity. So there is division of labor in reproduction. The queen and drones reproduce. The workers are not supposed to reproduce, but they can reproduce sometimes. And there is also colony division of labor in colony development. The worker, and between the workers, there is a division of labor. Okay, so the honeybees have a high degree of sociality based on communication. So there was a film, but oops. I don't know what I did.
Oh. Well, we have time.
Yeah.
No, this is mine. No, this is.
Okay. Okay.
There. No. There.
Okay. There. Here. Okay. So there is a film. Yeah, this film. What?
Que no. Que era un video.
The first video was working, so the second should work also.
One is the video?
Yeah. So the one of the best example of communication is waggle dance. So as you can see, this forager is indicating the way to go forage to their other workers. And the waggle dance is based on different cues, physical, vibrational, and chemical. So, but today we will focus on chemical communication in the colony, knowing that they have also other means to communicate. Okay, so chemical communication is one of the most fascinating aspects of social insects biology. All the social insects, ants, wasps, termites, and so on, they use a releaser and primer pheromone to communicate and for social regulations. So what is a releaser pheromone? It's a compound which is produced by one individual of the colony, or maybe more individuals, and which induce a rapid behavior to the receiver. And a very classical example is the sex pheromone, which attracts the male to mate. So it's very simple. There is also primer pheromone. So when there is hundreds of releaser pheromone identified in animal kingdom, there is only a few primer pheromone identified. What is a primer pheromone? It's a pheromone which is produced by one or few individuals, which induce a deep change, physiological change to the receiver. For example, you are the workers of the colony, and I am the queen. I am the king, let's say. She's the queen. And so at the moment, I want to reproduce. I don't want you, the males, to reproduce. So I am producing volatile compounds which will castrate you. So I am the only one for the female. Okay? But don't worry, we will not be too long together, and that will not act on you, so no problem. Okay, but it's exactly what's happened in the colony. The queen, and also we will see the brood, do that. And so it's we don't know how to categorize this behavior. Is it dominance, or is it other thing, or we will see that. Okay, so the big question is how the different actors of the colony communicate, the brood, the queen, the drone, and the workers all together. This is the big question. So if we make a little history of chemical ecology in the honeybee, the first releaser pheromones were identified in before the 60s, 1960s, as the attraction Nazanov pheromone, the alarm pheromone, and the forager trial pheromone, which was discovered by Martin Jurfa. Maybe you know this name. He is from Argentina, but now he's in France. And it's a good friend of me, by the way. And there is also Nesmith recognition pheromone, which are very, very important, you know? Nesmith recognition and guarding. You know the guarding process? So you have the guard, and you come back from foraging, and the guard will check, okay, you are from my nest, you can come. So usually in spring, if you are not from my nest, but you have some pollen to bring back, you can come. But the more important is in the fall. In the fall, there is less to forage, and there is le pillage, ça se dit comment, Anne? The robbing. Thank you very much, my old brain, sorry. And so there is robbing. So if this mechanism do not work perfectly, the colony will be robbed and will not survive the winter. So the adaptive pressure for the robbing is huge. To avoid that, they have this, what we call the Nesmith recognition. How it works, it's that there is cuticular hydrocarbon from the colony. Each colony has all the hydrocarbons, but in different proportion, profile. So each colony has their own profile of hydrocarbon compounds. And when young, so there is hydrocarbon compounds, there is feral pheromone of the queen, there is produced from the larvae, and also produced from the what they bring back from the foraging. All this make a very gentle bouquet of compounds. And this bouquet is learned. The first thing these emerging bees learn is the bouquet. So each bee of the colony will get the same bouquet with the same proportion. And then this is why you see the bees always checking them. Okay, you are my colony, you are my you are not of my colony, so go away. And if you don't go away, I kill you. Okay? So this is like when you go to the supermarket, you know there is a code bar, and okay, you can go, no, you didn't pay. So you have to pay. The same thing. Okay. Now let's see queen pheromone. Queen pheromone are very important, and they were studying in the 50s and in the 60s, and the first primer pheromone was discovered by Pain and Barbier and Butler in the 60s, and it was a very important discovery at this time. So the queen have an effect on retinue behavior. You know that this very beautiful behavior. The queen also produce the sex pheromone, which are from queen mandibular pheromone. The queen marks their eggs, which are recognized by the worker as good eggs. The queens produce 9-ODA, which is involved in swarming. And the queen has an effect on construction of queen cells. Okay? So let's see the queen pheromone and retinue behavior. So this is this wonderful behavior, which is very important because when the queen walk on the frame, it induces this behavior, and the worker will lick and would touch by contact with the antennae the queen, and will get this primer pheromone, which is 9-ODA and other compounds. Okay, so, and then the queen pheromone will spray in the colony like that. Okay, so the retinue behavior was studied by Keith Slessor and Mark Winston at this time, and they found that there is five produce compounds by the mandibular gland, which are 9-ODA, 2-9-HDA, HOB and HVA. And the interesting thing is that when you put the compounds together with 9-ODA, there is synergy. For example, if you test the 9-HDA alone, you will not get the retinue behavior. If you test the 9-ODA, you will get a little response. But if you put them together, that will have synergetic effect. And so he found that those five compounds has a synergetic effect on queen mandibular pheromone. But it was not all the story. Something was missing. So after a few years of study, he found other compounds like methyl oleate. Remember that. I will ask you the question later. Which one is produced by the queen? So if you don't reply, I will be very upset. No. So methyl oleate, so they are not in the queen mandibular, in the mandibule pheromone. They are outside. We don't know yet, but they are outside. So methyl oleate, palmityl alcohol, linolenic acid, and coniferyl alcohol. All that, they produce all response, which is called by Slessor queen retinue pheromone. Okay? And so you have 9 compounds. Okay, so the queen mandibular pheromone has an effect on the inhibition of worker ovary, which is very interesting when you know the retinue behavior. So the queen mandibular inhibit the ovary of the workers, and as the compounds are spread in the colony through the this behavior, the retinue behavior, so the pheromone is spread to all the workers. So at this time, it was the first primer pheromone identified, and it was very important for science. So the 9-ODA is also very important because we found with our two teams that the 9-ODA stimulate the building of the wax comb and stimulate the worker size. which makes sense, because when the queen is swarming, first thing they will do when they got a good place to build the nest is building wax, but worker wax. They don't need drone wax at this time. They only need drone wax when the colony is full. And then we believe that when the colony is full, there is maybe the same amount of queen mandibular pheromone produced, but it is diluted in the colony. And in this case, they will build up in drone cells, and they will also build up queen cells to swarm. This is what we believe is a swarming process. Okay? Now, what about brood pheromone? Brood pheromone, it's very important in the colony, but we don't know what's happened on the communication. So for non-social insects, it's not easy, because the mother need to find a good place to lay eggs, which can be tricky. But after the eggs are laid, they are by themselves, and the caterpillar, for example, will feed by itself on the plant. It's not the case with social insect, where the brood is completely dependent of the adult. If you remove the nurses or the adult, the brood will die. You know that. So it means what? It means that the brood needs to be recognized by nurses, their age, the caste, the sex, the needs, feeding, thermoregulation, and pollen needs, and so on. But we knew also since a long time that there is primary effect on open brood, means the larvae, on ovary development and hypopharyngeal glands of the nurses. The larvae would inhibit the ovary development of the nurse and will stimulate hypopharyngeal glands, which means, if we want to be anthropomorphic, that please, you don't develop your ovary, but you develop your nursing system for me. Okay, so I have two ways to present my story. It can be very formal, or it can be more fun. So I don't know what you want. Fun? You sure everybody wants the fun? Okay, so I will give you the fun. So a few years ago, when I was a PhD student, it was fun, huh? So I was searching for pheromone produced by the larvae, which could attract the varroa mite to reproduce in the cells. Okay, so we found at this time 10 compounds. Those are methyl and ethyl esters of fatty acids, so it's quite a common compound. And so we found those compounds. Three of them was active to attract the mite. But the more interesting thing is that we found 5 to 20 more esters during the capping of the cells. So at this time, we had the idea that it could be a capping pheromone. So what I did, I used a very thin syringe, and I put the pheromone on those larvae which are just before the capping, and I compare with no compounds, and one was missing. And I found that they would cap the cells very much earlier when you use the esters, the blend of esters. So what I did, I made a dummy, so it's paraffin dummy, and I included each of the compounds at different doses, and I put them back in a brood frame in the center of the colony, and look what happened. So it was just, you know, like fishing, tuna fishing, and a dream for me. No, they are not so stupid to do it, you know. And so, because you want the story, it was on jeudi, c'est Thursday. So on the Friday, I went back to the colony with a plastic sheet to see if they cut, and of course nothing worked. I saw my dummies and nothing. Okay, forget it. You try it, it's okay. Go back home. And on the next Monday, I was with my suit and my smoker for another experiment, and I walked near this colony. I hesitated and I said, oh, okay, let's try, we never know. So I took the frame and I don't see any dummy, so I said, maybe it's not a good frame. But yeah, it was a good frame. So I said, maybe it's because they remove all them. So I went back to my plastic sheet, but in fact they have capped, you know. So to me it was wow. So I went back to the lab. I said, oh yeah, look. No. And it was, you know, I say that for the student. You have to be very open. Because, you know, and science sometimes it's only luck. In my case, I was lucky, and it was a mind that I continue to work on all my life, you know. So I will give you after that the story. So methylpalmitate, oleate, linolenate, and linoleate induce the capping of the cells. You can try, it's fun for your student, for example, to do that. And then I was working with a team in Marseille, which was working on other social insects, and they were very much interested by the cuticular hydrocarbon profiles and the blend, what do the blend. And so we have the idea to look at the blend of esters on young and old larvae. So we found these differences. As you see, there is a totally different pattern of the young larvae and the old larvae. And what I did, it's to use the same tool, which is a dummy with a blend of the young larvae compared to the blend of the old larvae, right? Okay, I could do that. You understand? Yeah. So what was my test? Because in this case, the more tricky is a bioassay. If you have a good bioassay, you win. But sometimes it's difficult to find a bioassay. And my bioassay was to use a queenless big colony without queen, without brood. So I put a big swarm, but no queen in it. Why? No? You don't guess? Nobody? Because when they are queenless, the bees, they would choose a very early stage larvae to build a queen cells, right? So I say, if it is a blend of young larvae, they will work queen cells on the on the dummy with the young larvae, and this is what happened. So, yeah, and you know, this is old larvae blend and young larvae blend. So this bouquet moved and is a chemical signature of the I am an old one or I am a young one. Okay? So we also found that those compounds are in, involved in the recognition of queen cells. As we are working in the like here, INIA, we are supposed to find solutions for beekeeping and for agriculture and so on. So we say maybe we could use these compounds to in royal jelly production. So what we have done, we have put, oops, alors attends, non. We put the, some are missing, I am sorry. Okay, we put the different compounds in the wax of the caps used for royal jelly, okay? And what we found that with one compound, they would breed more queen cells. With another compound, this one, they will put more jelly per cap. And with one other compound, they will produce a bigger larvae. Okay. So I don't know what's happened with my presentation. They are missing. Okay. So, and finally, we found that those esters are produced, are released by the salivary gland. We don't know where they are produced. Maybe I will have time to look at that. We should use precursor and look where we found this in the body. It may be a build up in the hemolymph and bring by transporter protein inside this salivary glands or build up in the salivary gland. At the moment we don't know, but they are for sure released by the salivary gland. Okay, so other team worked on this pheromone, and Tania Panquiu was one of this team, and they found that the blend of esters stimulate pollen foraging and sucrose responsiveness of the bees. So basically you can see that there is a lot of releaser effect of those esters, right? So after that, we continue fishing, and we say, okay, there is a behavior effect of those compounds. We know that the brood has an effect on ovary development and hypopharyngeal gland development. Let's see if they have an effect. So to do that, we use a cage experiment. So you put 80 bees in this cage, and you will give the compounds or not, and see if they develop ovaries and or not, and if they they stimulate hypopharyngeal glands. And we use a natural condition colony, which are triple cohort colony. We call that one cohort of emerging bees, one cohort of nurse bees, and one cohort of foraging bees, 500 each. So we put them on from the same colony, and we know we have the same kind of bees and colony in it. And what we found that ethylolate and methylpalmitate stimulate hypopharyngeal glands of the bees, and ethylpalmitate and methylenolate inhibit the worker ovary development. Okay? So there are primary effects on the esters. So based on these results, we made the hypothesis that the brood pheromone could have an effect on division of labor of the bees, and particularly on behavioral development of nurses. Why? We knew at this time that juvenile hormone induce a decrease of hypopharyngeal glands of the nurses. We knew that juvenile hormone increased behavioral development, induce the behavioral development of nurses. So if you treat one nurse with a juvenile hormone or even analog like metoprene, she will become a forager very, very quickly. So our hypothesis was that the brood pheromone could decrease juvenile hormone level and it would stay hypopharyngeal glands develop, and it would reduce the age at increase the age at foraging, so the bees would stay at home. And basically, it would means if you are the brood, please you stay home because I need you to feed me, and so develop your hypopharyngeal glands and don't go forage. Okay, so we test this hypothesis. At this time, I met with Gene Robinson at the University of Illinois, and he was studying division of labor. So division of labor is based on what we call age polyethism. You know probably for sure what is it. They would do all those tasks in function of their age. And when they have about 21 days old, they will go for guarding or foraging. Okay, so we can say that there is two kind of activity, inside activity or outside activity. So this is the first part, and the other very important part is that there is very important plasticity in behavioral development. And in the colony, for a lot of mechanism, huge plasticity, so that they win. So we know that usually they go forage at 21 days, but I can make you make a bee forage at 4 or 5 days old, or you can also delay the age at foraging. And we have seen workers which became foragers, reversing and become nurses again. So there is a lot of plasticity. And at this time, Gene Robinson and others have found that the queen mandibular pheromone, or QMP, has an effect on behavioral development of the nest bees, of the nurse. So they will stay home. And you can see that as a beekeeper, because if you remove the queen, the bees will become, you know, go outside forage and they don't stay home, right? So so we hypothesis that it could be also the case for the brood. So we did also cage experiment, and this kind of experiment also, natural condition experiment. And we found that the brood pheromone, the 10 esters, decrease juvenile hormone level inside the bees and increase age at foraging, so they stay home. So it means also that the more brood there is, more nurse we need, and vice versa. And that we can say that the brood chemically manipulate the nurses, right? Is it okay? So there is primary effect of the brood esters on hypopharyngeal glands, worker ovary, and behavioral development of nurses. And the same team in the US, Smedal et al., found that there is also an effect suppressing physiology of extreme longevity in honeybees. So after that, with a student of me, We looked at the volatile because it's kind of old story that I am telling you. But 10 years ago, we got new tools, quite easy tools, the SPME in chemistry, to study volatile. And we say, let's see what's happened with very volatile compounds. And Alban Maisonas found this E beta osimen produced by the young larvae, and which has an effect on ovary development. So another compound having an effect of ovary development. And with so we found that there is also an effect on worker behavioral development, so age at foraging, but in this case it stimulates age at foraging. So it means when you are young larvae, you would say the nurse, please go forage because probably we need food to be feed. But after, when you get old larvae, you are fed, but you need bees to warm up the brood, so please you stay home. This is how we explain these two phenomena. But we may be wrong. I mean, if we are wrong, but it's not a problem. Okay, so with Rob Page and Kirsten Trainor, who came in my lab, working on beta osimen, we confirmed that beta osimen inhibit ovary development, but also there is an effect on foraging division of labor for pollen. And in the case of bees which have a high number of ovarioles, it stimulates hypopharyngeal gland development. Okay, so another primary effect of beta osimen. Okay, so now to conclude with brood pheromone. So brood is this larvae. Larvae, you see those larvae, they are not very exciting insect or whatever. Huh? You agree with me compared to a forager? But those larvae, even if they are not so exciting, they can do exactly the same compared to mammals. When the mammals has a puppy, the puppy will stimulate the mother with different cues. It can be chemical, it can be, I am crying, so the lactation, and so there is different cues, and they are known. But in fact, those ugly larvae, they do exactly the same with using chemical communication, which is to me fascinating. Okay, so it's okay? You are not sleeping too much? We make a break? No? Okay, let's continue. So I was lucky to meet with Gene Robinson. And he was working, so we did this. I went in his lab to look at juvenile hormone and behavioral development. And when I went back, he was working on the worker-worker interaction. And he has already found that there is an inhibition of old larvae to the young larvae. So if you have a lot of foragers, the nurses will stay home, and vice versa. And he was searching for the cue. So it could be a physical cue. For example, I will close the door here, and you will stay home. But it's not the case for the bees. So we check, and we will spend hours in the front of, what we call a colony with a glass, whatever. We spent a lot of hours and we didn't see anything. So we guess it was chemicals. So we knew that the queen, the brood, and old larvae had an effect on behavioral development, and we were searching for a cue produced specifically from the old bees. And after 8 years of work, finally we found that ethyl oleate is produced by the old workers, old bees, foragers, and inhibit the development, behavioral development of the nurse. So the nurse stay home. Okay? So when you have a lot of foragers, they produce ethyl oleate and the nurse stay home. And vice versa, when you have little foragers, so they do not produce a lot of ethyl oleate, and the nurse will go forage very early. Okay, so we published this because he was searching for that for years, Gene Robinson. So we were lucky to publish that in PNAS, which is a high level ranked paper. And then with Erika Plettner and I, we decided, Erika Plettner was working in the Simon Fraser University with Mark Winston and Keith Lesor, and I was working already with them. So we decided with Erika to try a Human Frontier for Science program to see what is, to study the life cycle of this pheromone. How is it produced, where, which genes involved, and so on. And so we knew that the ethyl oleate is made from ethanol and oleic acid. But what is the enzyme, and so on? So it was a question. And we found that it is formed in the esophagus of the bee. And the ethanol is taken from nectar of flowers, but or maybe also probably from the bio, the gut, the gut of the bees. And oleic acid, you can find a lot of it in pollen, but also everywhere in the body of the worker. We found that ethyl oleate is formed by this carboxyl esterase, and it moved from the honeycrop to the exoskeleton and is transmitted by contact to the nurse bees. Okay, so all that was published. We believe that building this pheromone is the way to detoxify the bees from ethanol, which is the case also for humans. Because yesterday night we went to have a few beers, did we? And if I take one hair, let's say, of I, because I don't want to tell you who drink beer. You take one hair, you will find ethyl oleate to detoxify. So the question is, what are the bees foraging? Why they are foraging on flower? Is there because they need sugar, or do they go to the bar like we do, or both? But in fact, it's a very serious question. You know, we have the same detoxifying process, and the question is, do they have choice? Because you can find yeast everywhere outside, in flowers and so on. And when it's very warm, so the nectar would produce ethanol. They may not have choice. So if they have choice and they go for alcohol, we will be very disappointed. Because we have this image, you know, of the forager, they go for it and they work so hard. But in fact, they go, like us, to the bar. And you know, Tugrul Giray, Chol, Professor Tugrul Giray, in, c'est quoi, Lille? Puerto Rico Island. He has this Africanized bees, which are gentle and very resistant. It's a good friend of me, and he sent me a few students, and we have a collaborative project together. And the preliminary results to test this hypothesis is that some bees, they never go to alcohol. Some bees, they go sometimes. And some bees, when they are tested alcohol, they will go to alcohol all the time. So it's maybe like us, you know. So it's a fun. Okay. So to to conclude, it's very interesting to see that, for example, the case of ethyl oleate. Ethyl oleate is built up, it's produced by the larvae. By the all bees, but also by the queen. And the three different actors of the colony produce these compounds to give the message to the nurses, please you stay nurses. We don't need you outside, you stay. Okay? So ethyl oleate is also a sex pheromone from the varroa mite. Okay. So this other the ethyl methyl palmitate and ethyl palmitate and methylene oleate are also they are produced by the larvae, but they are also attractive for the mite. So it's produced by the larvae, and they might use these compounds to find the larvae. So they are at the center of the social regulation, and even with the varroa mite. So for example, we have this methyl oleate. Methyl oleate induces the capping of the cells, but methyl oleate is also produced by the queen. Is it the one I show you before or not? Are you sure? Who say yes? Okay, you are right. You are right. Okay, so in this case, the behavioral response is context dependent. You will not see a worker trying to cap a queen, you know? So depending on the context, we have two different responses. Okay, look at ethyl oleate. It's produced by the larvae as a signal of age of the larvae. I am a young larvae. But it's also a primer pheromone. So the same compounds has releaser effect and primer effect, right? So it's much more complicated than we saw when we started this program. And when you see the butterfly sex pheromone, we are much, much more complicated than that. Okay? Okay, so in case of, we gave a definition of the colony pheromone, and there is also one pheromone which is interesting, which it's ethyl oleate from the queen, because ethyl oleate is not attractive to the bees. But in this case, ethyl oleate will be transmitted through the retinue behavior to the nurses, and this is what we call passenger pheromone. You know, faire du stop, hitchhiking pheromone, right? So we propose this definition. Okay, is it okay with you for that? Now we will go in genomics. Not a lot, but just to give you the story. So in 1906, the US produced the first honeybee genome, and Gene Robinson was the first to use it to look at gene expression. So he started by DNA chips, and he looked at the difference of gene expression between nurses and foragers. And what he found, each line is a gene, and you can see that there is a gene template which are overexpressed in young nurse compared to old foragers. So there is a pattern of gene expression of young nurses versus old foragers. Okay? So when Gene published that, we were very excited to put our pheromone stuff in it to see if we would find the same template if we put, for example, queen pheromone or brood pheromone when we give it to the nurses. And what we found that giving QMP or brood pheromone will give you a template of young nurse. Okay? You understand what I say? So it was, to us, it was nice because we could go to the gene expression level. So what do we do now? What do we know now? Excuse me. Probably not a lot. Because, for example, when you see a queen here, we know a lot on mandibular gland pheromone, but there is also a special gland in the tarsal gland, which were identified and histology and some produce was found at this maybe 30 years ago, but we don't know what they are doing. The same for the tergal gland of the queen. They are very much identified, but we don't know what they are doing. And they are specific to the queen. So you imagine that it's much more complicated. So last week, this paper was published, and they looked at different compounds of the queens. And they looked at different compounds of tergal glands and this gland and Dufour glands, and they found that compounds from the tergal glands have an effect on ovary development of the nurses. So it's a good step because we have new compounds to play with, and maybe that will be interesting to complete this chemical ecology story in the honeybees. So what do we have to do to continue to characterize pheromone compounds? To go from the genes to pheromone, but also from pheromone to the genes to see all the different step mechanism. And okay, so I have 10 minutes. Yeah? Okay. You want me to continue or we can stop here? Okay.
After this presentation, we have a coffee break.
Okay. So now I will speak about, it's also something to, because it's a long talk. For me also, sometimes I am confused between the larvae and the old, you know, to concentrate, it's difficult. No. It's just to keep, you know, the attention of the public to play. I play with you like that, and we go back. Okay, so colony losses and chemical communication. So you know that there is a lot of stressors on colony at the moment, and colony losses, we know the stressors, most of the stressors, I would say. And the question is, those stress could act on chemical communication, which could at least partly explain colony losses. So it could be those factors could disrupt pheromone communication. It could be a change in pheromone production. Because I am stressed, I would produce more or less of this pheromone, and it will disorganize social regulation, for example. Or it could be also the perception mechanism. I got some pesticides on my antennae, and I cannot recognize a brute pheromone or whatever. So I will speak about this because we didn't do a lot on this level, but it's still to do. So what we have done, we have given, so it's Claudia Dusoba who did that. Some of you, you know her, so I wanted to say that to you. And what she have done, she gave imidacloprid or Nosema to emerging bees, and they look and we look what happened to the production of ethyl oleate of those bees. Ethyl oleate, you remember, this is what? Pheromone of what? Of larvae, but also of all bees. Okay, so they produce all bees, they produce this pheromone, and so the nurse will stay home, right? Okay, so we concentrate on this ethyl oleate, and as you can see, there is no effect of imidacloprid on the production of ethyl oleate, but there is a huge effect of Nosema on ethyl oleate. So it means that they will produce a lot of pheromone to say to the to the nurse, to stay nurse. Okay. So we build up this honeybee counter. Didier Creuser, you know Marisa? Marisa? Yeah? So Didier Creuser is a husband of Marisa. I say that for the Chilean, because she is from Chile. So Didier build up this counter, and as you can see, we can mark the bees. And so some of those bees, we give Nosema or not, we give imidacloprid or not, and we looked at foraging behavior in and out exit of the bees. It's okay with you? And what we found that, again, when you give a Nosema, they will produce much more ethyl oleate. And when you give Nosema, they will forage earlier, but they will die also much earlier compared to the control bees. Claudia. Okay? So it was a very interesting work, and it's interesting because we have a problem testing bees in the field, but with this apparatus, honeybee counter, they are in the field, they are in a real environment, they are just marked, and we can see what they are doing in a natural situation. So with Cédric and others, we looked at the a difference of pheromone production in the queen mandibular pheromone, when they are with Nosema, gray bars here, they have Nosema, they produce more 9-ODA, but they also produce less HOB. So what it means, we don't know. But this is what we found. It may be also a modification of the Honest signal. The Honest signal is very interesting. We know that there is a Honest signal produced by the queen. It means, yes, I am a queen, I am in a good shape. If I am in a bad shape, we super sedure. You see that, you know that. So there is a signal, a honest signal, but we don't know what is a honest signal. Maybe it's this one. I am not sure, but maybe this is this one plus other compounds, probably. But maybe it's also a signal from the brood, because a bad queen will produce less brood, so, you know, we don't know. Maybe it's brood plus, we don't know yet. But the fact that Nosema could change this profile, probably, maybe it's also important, is a modification of honest signal. And this is what we found also, I could add this this work with Claudia. Because Claudia used smile NUX, smile, you know what is a NUX? Smile colony, and put control virgin queens, or virgin queens with Nosema, or virgin queen with imidacloprid, or both. And what she found, because the hypothesis would be that with imidacloprid they will not be able, they will go mating, but they will not be able to go back, but they did. And with Nosema the same, they will have an effect, but no effect. So all those queens were mated, all those queens started to lay eggs, but all those queens, after 3 months, they were superseded, all of them, and not the control. Superseded, they died. Okay. Another experiment that we have done with Cynthia, we looked at cuticular hydrocarbons when we give Nosema to the to adult bees, and you have to compare the same color. You know, here you have different patterns of cuticular hydrocarbons when they have Nosema here compared to here, the same here, and so on. So we have significant effect that Nosema can change the cuticular hydrocarbon profile of the adult bees, which is important because they are involved in recognition of the colonial odor, right? So there is the same with varroamite. So to reply at this question, yes, a stress can disrupt the pheromone production in the honeybee colonies. Okay. So, chemical ecology of the honeybees is very important for social communication, social regulation in the colony. Is also a base of host-parasite relationships. A lot have been done on this field, but a lot still have to be done to decipher all the mechanisms. And it's a wonderful field of investigation. So go in this field if you want. It's fascinating. So I give you my story. It was a long. It's not a few years ago. Unfortunately, it was more than 30 years of research with wonderful people. So this is some people of my lab. It's not a new picture, but we were a lot working on this program. And yeah, it was a wonderful experience to me. As I say, maybe before yesterday, to you, some of you, when I got this position in my institute, I didn't want to put too much competition, because during my PhD I had a lot of competition. Ah, go, because people from Germany are working on the same subject and they will, you know, and it was not really nice. So don't be naive, there is competition, but my strategy was to go and meet with the good scientists like Mark Winston, Keith Lesser, Erika Plettner, Jean Robinson, Rob Page, so they are well known. Zachary Wang, a very good friend. We are friends with Zachary Wang and Tru Jire. So we were together in Jean's lab. So what I did, I don't want so much competition because I will collaborate. So collaborating with good scientists give me, you know, big opening. I grew up with them, and we became friends. So, you know, everything is nice. So if you want to visit us, you can see this kind of picture with Lavender Honey. You know, thank you very much.